most people throughout history have probably had an experience, an event or a moment where they have had an encounter with what I would call the numinous life, a moment of awe and wonder. Equally, I would suggest most people have and continue to live content with occasional moments that may come or go, not by choice, but not particularly seeking a deeper dive into those moments of greater awareness or insight. This applies to people of religious perspectives or persuasions and non-religious alike. And most people who live in such a way make choices to live with good values, ethical living, and perhaps from time to time choose to engage in acts of justice and peacemaking. So I want to begin today by saying humanity can live justly and ethically with or without belief in God as the reference point. Even without any seeking or hunger for a deeper awareness into the numinous. And the experience of the numinous, however fleeting, comes to people of religion and faith and people of no faith and religion. The numinous is not biased. So my reflections, while for any who may be so inclined to listen, are for those who seek a deeper dive into the numinous experience. They are for people who believe in God but don't hold to a traditional view of God. They are for those who perhaps once believed in a deity or supreme being but can no longer and wonder if there is a different way of conceptualizing what in the past has been captive to the categories of conservative and orthodox Christianity. And my reflections are for those who may see themselves as interspiritual, spiritual but not religious, and maybe perennialists, those who seek to rest and flow and be reminded of the deep connection we have with all matter, all energy, all soul, all spirit, and how it transforms our human living.
Thank you.
About 60 times, a bit less if you take away the parallel stories in the gospel, Jesus is referred to as teacher or good teacher or rabbi. And almost always the question is regarding the numinous life. The questioner comes and says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to be saved? How can I be born again? What does God require of me according to the law, etc., etc.? And in Jesus' time, the language of the kingdom of God or the realm of God or eternal life or being born again was the way in which the people conceptualized the numinous life. And we can notice that Jesus' response invited the questioner to ask something of themselves. Who am I asking the question? Basically, Jesus would invite the questioner to have a good look in the mirror. That would lead to a change of perspective, a transformed awareness, a confrontation of the self, and an honest appraisal. Now, in seeking the numinous, Jesus teaches that the evidence of the experience of the numinous will transform awareness of the world, awareness of Yahweh, awareness of the self, awareness of the other, particularly those who we other and are prejudiced against because of culture, nationality, religion, or those who we other who we consider outcasts or marginalised. So what is the numinous, or how do we define it or describe it? The word numinous was first coined by the 19th and 20th century theologian, German theologian, Rudolf Otto, who basically came up with the word using the Latin and the Greek numen idea. And Otto felt that there was a need for a word to describe the concept of the holy or the divine without the moral factor or rationality normally attached to the word holy or God. Being holy had come, and probably still does mean in the church, being sinless, being without fault, living a God-fearing, godly life with all the ethical and moral overtones that that has come to mean. And Otto sought to describe something that would contain a sense of both a state of mind and a sense of the holy. Now, Carl Jung coined a word, numinism, or numinosum, which he defines as a dynamic effect that can be either a visible or invisible presence and quality that causes a particular alteration of the consciousness. So rather than what we normally associate with God as being all positive and good and loving and gentle and kind and beautiful, Otto and Jung note that the experience of the numinous is paradox, and it contains what we might call positive and negative, things that can be experienced simultaneously that are seemingly opposed to each other. Otto and Jung speak of holy awe and holy dread. And I guess for me an example would be when a loved one dies, we don't experience love on its own or gratitude or peace alone, no matter how much we try to orientate our mind towards that. Our experience of grief and death is both gratitude and agony, splendor and tragedy, pain and thankfulness. And we know in life that we can at one and the same time experience awe and fear, excitement and trembling, bliss and bewilderment, attraction and horror, allure and repulsion, exaltation and humility. And these experiences of what we might call the numinous life elude our ability to comprehend them in the normal categories. We cannot simply attain knowledge from them. As mystery, the encounter bewilders the rational, logical mind. When I was in my final year of Bible College, Theological College and ministry training, past students would always come back and give us a session advising us on their learnings of their first few years of ministry. And I recall in my final year, a student returning and telling us, or a minister returning after being out for 2 years, and telling us that we all needed to use the KISS principle. Keep it simple, stupid. And basically they said, don't preach or reflect on things that require overthinking or diving deeper into things or conceptualizing too much. Just give people the practical stories of Jesus as a sensible guidance for living. And we were told that that is what people in the congregation want. Well, I don't know about you, but if I reflect on my whole life's experience going back to my childhood, there is no keep it simple, stupid when it comes to the numinous. The encounter cannot be simplified or reduced to moral stories on how God wants us to live or our practical guides to ethical living. But alas, we are tempted to simplify Jesus' teaching of the numinous into practical steps for living that create a dualism between the transcendent encounter and our desire for neat categories with which to structure our life. Frederick Schleiermacher, who we could describe as the father of liberal progressive theology, describes the experience of the numinous life as the intuition and feeling of the infinite. And psychologist William James says that the numinous is a sense of reality of the objective presence and perception of something there. And with regards to holy awe and holy dread, I think of the story of Adam and Eve and that mythical experience. And there are other biblical examples where the experience of the numinous caused fear and fright and the desire to flee when standing in the awe of the numinous life. St. Paul, the originator of what we might call the Christian tradition and the Christian movement, had a significant experience that we might call a conversion, which changed his whole focus and way of life. Whether we get caught up in the literal nature and cause of his conversion, his experience of the numinous confronted him with holy awe and holy dread. The holy awe and holy dread of his life and his actions. Saul, he hears a voice saying, "Why do you persecute me?" But who was Paul persecuting? He was persecuting humans who were people of the way, the followers of the new way of Jesus, and followers of a renewed experience of the numinous. So the numinous experience not only is of awe, but a true confronting of the self. For when I look deeply into the mirror, I not only see my kind, loving, caring self, but I see my judgmental, critical, prejudiced self. In a way, to have an encounter of the numinous life is actually to encounter myself and there to stand in holy awe and holy dread. For the honest human, this holy awe and holy dread cannot be avoided. And when I observe this life with holy awe and holy dread, I'm humbled and changed, converted and transformed. But this takes time, and it also should be a hunger. The go-to for all Christians when we want to simplify practical living is the Good Samaritan and the advice to love your neighbour as yourself. But in the story, Jesus invites the lawyer to take a good hard look at himself. True love of neighbour cannot be separated from the inner self transformation. For when the lawyer knows himself and confronts his life with holy awe and holy dread, then he will know himself and who his neighbour is in love. Holy awe and holy dread perhaps might be summed up in this song by Sting.
And steel are one, drying in the color of the evening sun. Tomorrow's rain will wash the stains away, but something in our mind will always stay. Perhaps this final act was meant to clinch our lifetime's argument that nothing come from violence and nothing ever could. For all those born beneath an angry star, lest we forget how fragile we are. On and on the rain will fall, like tears from a star, like tears from a star. On and on the rain will say how fragile we are. Fragile we are.
I wonder in what way we might understand the numinous as different to the conventional Christian God of the church. Why is this important? And what transformative impact does it have on the practicalities and the realities of our everyday living? Life is fragile. Life can sometimes be shocking. It is impermanent and it is fleeting as much as the morning dew. But most human goals, most human progress, most human values don't want to acknowledge this. Suffering and death are topics not discussed, while the concepts of how do we prolong life or how do we avoid discussion on the fragile, fleeting life is preferred and almost seen as a Christian virtue. For God has come to rescue us from this suffering and fleeting life, we might suppose. Christianity has, for the most part of its existence, been an anthropocentric religion. Christianity has avoided the fragile and rather sought for the permanence, as God is permanent. The constructs of God that we have created for ourselves have put us humans above all creatures in the natural world. Nature and the animal world were and still are seen as a collection of resources for human progress and development. But Christianity in its earliest days had at its heart, in many of its communities, a deep connection to the rhythm of the seasons and nature. Early Christian communities, particularly in our Celtic tradition, arranged life around the seasons. Christianities saw wisdom in nature, nature as teacher, as mother, as source. It was not just that nature revealed to the human God, but that nature revealed to the human. But through the Industrial Revolution, technology took over and exploited the planet's resources for the benefit of human life over and against other life. Christianity is complicit in the progress of the human over and against all forms of nature. For the God we created placed us in the position of dominion and authority over all. But the encounter of the numinous life and the numinous way in Christianity, in all religious traditions and the indigenous traditions, is a way of living that brings an awareness that we as humans are in connection with all other life, and that this planet is our home, and that this cosmos is the home of this planet. Awareness of life and other life is the basis for compassion. Compassion doesn't impose itself or interfere with the other. Empathy doesn't oppress or demand of the other. Compassion and empathy invite harmony with the other, and harmony invites balance. When we are out of balance, we suffer, the other suffers, life suffers, nature suffers, and the cosmos suffers. St. Paul says that all creation groans. So to live in the presence and awareness of the numinous is to seek the balance, to be transformed by empathy and compassion. And when we live numinously, we know we are part of it all, that all life is cosmic being. We are no longer superior to others or other forms of matter and life. We don't judge others based on abstract ideas of religions or other criteria according to our own subjective ideals or prejudices. Thus, the numinous way, by its very nature, sets the way for the personal choices you and I make each day regarding our social interaction and our ethical and moral living with regards to the human life, to the environment, and to this planet that we call home, and the seeking and the hunger of the human soul to find its rest and peace. The numinous way is the way of namaste and peace, a constant recognition of life in me and life in the other, the same life, and that it will be well and in balance. So may it be well with you in your encounter of the numinous way, and may it be a constant craving.